إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله السميع العليم من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. Brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم and Ramadan Mubarak. Alhamdulillah, last week or last month we've been praying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us rich the month of Ramadan. So we used to say, Allahumma balighna Ramadan Mubarak and Shaban. Alhamdulillah, congratulations to all of you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has accepted our dua and we are here now in Ramadan. So Allahumma lak alhamd. My speech today on those seerah sessions, inshallah today will be a small reminder about the reward and the importance of the month of Ramadan. And the next part of my speech today will be an introduction on seerah, inshallah, and why we've chosen to talk about the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam during Ramadan. Now, I know that the speech about Ramadan is a seasonal speech, and that's if I was to ask you about the riwayat of Ramadan and ahadith and verses of Ramadan, then I have no doubt that all of you will know them very well. Let's have a non-classical talk about Ramadan. Let's try to understand the meaning of, for example, when we hear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala closes the gates of the hellfire and opens the gates of paradise. Why do we think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing this? When we hear as well that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is chaining the shayateen, the devils. The devils are put in chains. Again, why? Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doing all of this? And there is Laylatul Qadr. Laylatul Qadr khayrun min alf shahr. Again, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us these golden opportunities during the month of Ramadan? We should ask ourselves. And what is expected from us? When again we hear that, well, we know that the smell of our mouth now, we are fasting, it doesn't smell well. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that the odor and the smell of the mouth of the fasters are better in Allah's, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the odor of the misk. Why is this? We should ask ourselves this question. And we should ask ourselves, what is expected from us in the month of Ramadan? The month of Ramadan has great rewards. If you look at the hadith, the verses, we can summarize them, let's say, in 6 points. Inshallah, we will go through these points and try to boost our iman and boost our motivation to make this Ramadan the best Ramadan for ourselves. Okay? But we can call it a slogan for this year, inshallah. Let's make Ramadan this year our best Ramadan, best performance in terms of ibadah, in terms of worship, reading Quran, etc. And let's put ourselves targets to achieve. And this is what we do when you are students, when you have to prepare for your exams, you have to set targets to achieve every day. Say, I need to do this chapter, etc. Let's do exactly the same for Ramadan. Because we are very bad planners, we need to plan to achieve good performances. Let's say today, inshallah, I will read, let's say, just hey, two juz. I will give salaha. And I will do this and this and this. And after 2-3 days, let's see how I did. I can have a checklist. Okay, I did take it, yes, alhamdulillah. I prayed, Taraweeh, alhamdulillah. I fast, I didn't do any sins, alhamdulillah, etc. Let's measure your performance and your view of yourself. This is a good way of keeping track of how you do. Because by 15 days, at the middle of Ramadan, usually starts growing, fortunately. The first days, alhamdulillah, mosques are full. Everyone is praying, alhamdulillah, everyone is doing very well. But after 1 week, 2 weeks, back to normal. Let's not talk about after Ramadan, that's another subject, that's another topic. But even in Ramadan, there's a fluctuation. It starts very well, and in the middle, there's a problem. Let's inshallah try to keep steady. So the first reward, al-maghfirah, forgiveness. Now listen to this hadith carefully. صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا وغفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whoever fasts in the month of Ramadan, there's two conditions: out of sincere faith and hoping for the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then what's happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all his previous sins. You are 20, 30 years old, 60, 70. If you do these two conditions, you fast the month of Ramadan. First one, out of sincere faith. Second one, looking for the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and hoping for it. Then what's happened to you? A new page, like this. Well, this one is not that white, but imagine that's your book. No, has no say in that. It starts from scratch. Why? Because you fasted Ramadan, Iman, when he said. Look at this great reward. Well, we all have sins. We all have, you know, you can say, oh, subhanAllah, I did some very, very bad sins. Khamr, zina, riba. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't specify, he said all his sins. And he didn't put any exceptions. So it's a golden opportunity. It's a golden opportunity to review ourselves and to correct ourselves. And to get our sins forgiven. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَلَا تُحِبُونَ أَنْ يَغْفَرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Don't you like that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive your sins? Of course you do. And that's the opportunity for it. Don't delay. You don't know. You may not have the opportunity next year. You may not. You may be busy. You may be sick. You may not have the opportunity that you have this year. So take the opportunity while you have the time, while you have the health, alhamdulillah, while you have everything to do it. Don't delay, because shaitan wants you to delay. And now alhamdulillah, shaitan are changed. So we have no excuse. If there is something bad, it's our nafs. One can say, well, it's very difficult for me to keep the intention to perform very well in fasting during the whole month. Then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, there is another hadith that says, مَنْ قَامَ. Now it's not مَنْ صَامَ. مَنْ قَامَ رَمَضَانَ إِيمَانًا وَاحْتِسَابًا. Again, غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ. Whoever prayed at night, again, out of sincere faith and hoping for the reward, then what's happened? Again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all your previous sins. No exception. You start from scratch, like a baby who's just born. No sins. Forgiveness of all the sins. Again, you may say, well, 30 days, praying at night, one day I was sleepy, one day I wasn't very well, etc. Then another opportunity. Same type of hadith. مَنْ قَالَ لَيْلَةَ الْقَدْرِ إِيمَانًا وَاحْتِسَابًا غُفِرَ لَهُ. One night. Whoever established prayers on the night of Qadr, again, out of sincere faith, subhanAllah, look at these two conditions, very important conditions. Sincere faith, iman, it means you don't do it by habits, because back home in Islamic countries, people just fast, you know, because you know, everybody's fasting in the house, so they have to do it. They don't question it. They say, okay, Ramadan is here, we have to fast, etc. It's like an automatic process. There is no reflection on it. You don't reflect upon it, you just do it. And this is not what we're talking about. We're talking about sincere faith. And you do it and say, I want the ashr. I want the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what I'm looking for. If inshallah you fall in these two conditions, then inshallah, congratulations for you. Your sins are forgiven. So that's the first reward. Forgiveness of all the sins. No matter what you did before, no matter what your sins are, if you do this, inshallah, during this month, during this golden opportunity, then all your sins, inshallah, will be forgiven. So don't miss the opportunity. That's the key message. What else? There is more? Yes, of course. It's just the beginning. The list is long. Save me from the hellfire. And there are those who Allah frees from the hellfire in Ramadan, and this occurs every night. When did Ramadan start? Yesterday. After Maghrib, Ramadan starts. So yesterday, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had people saved from the hellfire. This could be you, or it doesn't have to be a scholar, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking into your heart. If you really want to be saved, and you are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be saved from the hellfire, then inshallah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will answer your dua. He is the one who answers the dua. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rejeeb the dua. So can you imagine? Saved from the hellfire. You know the Arabs, they used to have slaves. You know? And when they used to free their slaves, it wasn't good for them to just make them back to slavery. It wasn't good manners. Out of generosity and noblesse, they used to let them free. If they free them, they cannot go back and change their minds. فَمَا لَا Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most generous. And he's the most noble. If he frees you, if he saves you from the hellfire this year, inshallah, congratulations. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not put you on the hellfire. That's the key. It's the key thing that we have to understand. If you are saved from the hellfire today, for example, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala won't put you on the hellfire. That's it. You can say, well, I made the sins later. No, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you to worship him later. So your good deeds will always outbalance the bad deeds. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written you among the people who are saved from the hellfire. That's it. But so how many rewards do we have now? First one, maghfira, forgiveness. Second one, al-itq min al-nar. Saving from the hellfire. More? Na'am. There is more. Hasanat. Now I want to mention something here, because there is a hadith that we hear all the time, multiplication by 70. But if you do a nafila, it's like a fard, and if you do a fard, then it's multiplied by 70. This hadith is da'if. Okay? This hadith. This hadith is da'if. We have enough ahadith, authentic ahadith to use rather than going and looking for hadith da'if. And just between brackets, whenever you mention hadith da'if, you have to mention it. You say, oh, this is a weak hadith. Why? Because if you say, Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, people will just assume that it's authentic. They will just let people know about these hadiths. Send in emails, like the emails you receive every day, I'm sure you do. And half of them, if not more, are just hadiths of du'a or da'if, weak or light upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we have to be careful. Whatever we say, whatever we narrate upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it has to be true. Whoever lies intentionally upon me, then he kind of already booked his place in Jannah. So we have to be careful. So, back to Ramadan. Treasures of hasanat. Kullu amalin li adama. La illa siyam al-wali wa ana usiyu. This hadith is
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, whoever it is that you do, it's, the other is known. Unless it's the fasting. Fasting is for me, and I give a reward for it. Now, the scholars of Islam says, whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala don't specify the ajr, it's an indication of its greatness. Like in this hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't specify the number of hasanat or what exactly the reward is. He said, the ajr, I will take out. I will give the reward in the judgment day. This is an indication of its greatness. So we have great reward, forgiveness, and saving from the hellfire. The other thing is acceptance of the wrong. Acceptance of the wrong. The companion said, we used to supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Ramadan, and we never reach the next Ramadan without our supplications being answered. Okay? The dua that you do in Ramadan, inshaAllah, by next Ramadan, all your dua inshaAllah will be accepted. And of course, the sa'i in the Ramadan, that's all right. The person who is fasting, when he breaks his fast, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't refuse, or doesn't invalidate his dua. His dua is 100% accepted when he breaks his fast. So inshallah, when you break your fast, make dua. Because dua is accepted in this particular moment. The other thing, the other reward, the fifth one, is Laylatul Qadr. What's the average age? How long are we going to live? Roughly. Rasulullah said, Amar ibn Mashiach is 16 years old. That the average, the age of my Ummah is between 60 and 70. Okay. And how long do we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during these 70 years? If you take away the number of hours of sleep, six hours? How many hours do we work or do we study per day? Another 8? And how many hours do you spend eating, chilling out, doing this? How many hours do we actually spend in the worship? Maybe 1 hour then, if you take the five prayers. So it's 1/20th of our life. It's not that much. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us an opportunity. الله سبحانه وتعالى أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إنا أنزلناه في ليلة القدر وما أدراك ما ليلة القدر ليلة القدر خير من ألف شهر تنزل الملائكة والروح فيها بإذن ربهم من كل أمر سلام هي حتى مطلع الفجر. This is سورة القدر. خير من ألف شهر. This night, the worship of this night is actually multiplied by 1,000 months. Whatever you do during this month, time thousands. خير من ألف شهر. How many thousands more? Roughly it's 84 years. So if you read Quran during Laylatul Qadr, it's like actually you are reading Quran during 84 years. If you do Qiyam in Laylatul Qadr, it's like you were doing Qiyam for 84 years. SubhanAllah. But don't wait and don't say it's the night of 27th, as many people do. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he has been asked, Ya Rasulullah, is it this? He said, تَرَقَبُوهُ فِي الْعَشْرَ الْأَوَاخِرَ. And he was angry. Like you have the whole year, and now the 10 years you have greedy. Oh, is it this night? Is it the other night? SubhanAllah, it's the last 10 days. Don't be greedy with Allah. He's given you everything. And it's for you. That's God's importance. Last 10 days, there is Laylatul Qadr. Khairun al-Fishar. So last 10 days, we have to be focused. And one of our targets is not to miss the night of victory, night of Qadr. And subhanAllah, there is another hadith, very important hadith. You know, when the Prophet ﷺ climbed the minbar, and he said, Ameen, Ameen, Ameen. What does it mean? When you say Ameen, it's after the du'a. When I do du'a, I say Ameen. May Allah accept. That's what it means. Now the Prophet ﷺ said, Ameen, Ameen, Ameen. Companions, because they were intelligent people. They pay attention about what the Prophet ﷺ is doing. So they ask him, Ya Rasulullah, you've done something, we're not used to it. You haven't done this before. He said, Ameen, Ameen, Ameen. What's it? And the Prophet ﷺ told them, Jibreel came to me. He ordered me to say Ameen as well. So what do you think about Dua? Well, Jibreel, Ameen al-Salah, and the Prophet ﷺ, Ameen al-Ard, both are saying Ameen. Is this Dua accepted or not? Yes. No, no doubt that this Dua is accepted. So the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever reaches the month of Ramadan and does not have his sins forgiven, then may Allah distance him. Say Ameen. It's very critical meaning here. We have to think deeply on this. If you reach Ramadan, if you don't do what you have to do to be forgiven, then the Prophet said, may Allah distance you. What does it mean, distance you? Distance you means you're waiting for Ashr Awakhir and you get sick. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may have distanced you. And you later said, oh, subhanAllah, I didn't have the opportunity. I was a bit sick. Or, oh, you know, I was busy with the projects. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has distanced you. Because you didn't do what you had to do to be forgiven. So basically, the worship in Ramadan is not actually optional. It's not optional. You have to do what you need to do to be forgiven. Otherwise, you may fall in the meaning of this hadith. You didn't do what you had to do to be forgiven. Then Allah distance you. Okay. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we said, there is many things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for us. Forgiveness, saving from the hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing all these things for us. What's happening if you turn our back? That doesn't make sense. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing this for you. And you're just turning your back. There is something wrong. It's like when you invite someone, prepare everything. You prepare, you know, nice dishes, nice food, etc. And at the end of the day, you say, well, I'm busy, I can't make it. How do you feel about it? If something is done for you, prepared for you, made easy for you, and you turn your back, then be careful. So, may Allah distance me. We can understand it as, for example, you may be distanced from doing Laylatul Qadr. Something can happen during this night. Well, I've heard of many people who could not pray in Ashr al-Awakhir because they were sick. They had a flu or something. Remember, it's an opportunity. Don't miss it. Okay. Ramadan is not only about gathering, etc. It's like you're doing servicing for yourself. Again, that's another meaning of chaining the shayat, the demons. If I ask you, what does it mean? Yes, shayatin are chained. But what does it mean? The best person to describe this is someone who is running and there is a criminal behind him with a long knife. Running after him. What is this person doing? He's running as well. Because if this person is going to catch you, then he's going to kill you, no doubt. What if another person can stop the criminal? What do? You take safety instincts. You say, oh, jazakallah. And now I need to run very fast. I need to keep safety distance. So this criminal is not going to catch me again. This is exactly what's happening with ourselves and Shaitan. Shaitan is behind us, everywhere. You come to pray, he's there, he's doing waswasa. You want to do any good deeds, and he's there, doing waswasa, don't do it, come on, etc. He's behind us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, during this month, okay. The devils are chained. What do you do? Take safety distance. That's what it means. Take distance by worship, by coming closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's like servicing. You need to service your, as you service your car, you need to service yourself. Because you have some free time. You haven't let shaitan to disturb you. You need to focus on yourself and to review yourself. Fix yourself. Purify your heart. Purify your heart. Time is approaching. There is still lots to say about Ramadan. The pious predecessors, how they used to prepare for Ramadan, how they used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Ramadan. Look at Imam Malik, rahimahullah, for example, when Ramadan starts, and he starts focusing on Quran, he said, no hadith anymore, only Quran. And Shafi'i used to read Quran, to recite Quran 60 times in Ramadan, twice a day. Now you can see this is impossible, subhanAllah. This is narrated upon Shafi'i, you know Shafi'i. He used to recite Quran twice a day during Ramadan. And the pious predecessors, they used to, it's common that they finish Quran in 3 days. And in Ashur, the last 10 days, every night. This is common. Now we may not reach this level, but they are our role models and we need to do our best to do maybe just 30% or even less, or even 10% of what they've done. But they are our models and we need to follow them, inshallah. So, things to do in Ramadan. First one, make dua for Allah's presence to make you rich Ramadan. It's done. Alhamdulillah. So we need to thanks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this opportunity to get this huge reward and to be forgiven. Then, happiness, because this is a sunnah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to make his companions happy of the coming of Ramadan. Because it's a great event, great Islamic event. What else? Have the intention to occupy your times efficiently. Don't be distracted, you know, there is Facebook, Twitter, whatever. There's a lot of ways of wasting time. So we need to be careful. Alhamdulillah, you are students. You have exams to prepare thesis, etc. Do the intention that what you are doing is for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So even the time that you spend in your study will be counted in your hasanat. Occupy your time efficiently. Don't waste your time. Time is precious in Ramadan. A year and a half, a few days. You will see, inshallah, after, you know, you will see that, oh, this is half of Ramadan. This is the last 10 days. You will go quickly. So stay focused and manage your time efficiently. Seek the knowledge of the rulings of sin. Okay? You cannot start to worship without having the knowledge for it. When you pray, you need to have the knowledge of the prayer. Otherwise, how do you expect to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? There is a minimum of knowledge that we need to see. When we pray, when we do wudu, when we go to Hajj, you cannot go to Hajj and, you know, it's not tourism. You need to know the rulings, the fiqh rulings of it. Same as Siyam. Now Ramadan starts, we need to see a minimum of knowledge concerning the rulings of Siyam. That's what I wanted to say about Ramadan. A few words of the seerah. Inshallah, next time we will start talking about the beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that we all love. And why did you choose to talk about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about his seerah? Four reasons. First one, because it's the most successful revival experience. The most successful revival experience is that of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay? His revival lasted more than 1,000 years because it was built on sacrifice, faith, planning, and confidence. So that's the first reason. The second one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. It's the best example that you can find. And al-uswa in Arabic is more than a role model. He's, a role model is in a particular field. Someone can be my model in science. The other one can be my model in management. The other can be my model in sports. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and there is a great wisdom on this, is your model in everything. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made his life a fodder for different things. He was a father. He was oppressed. He was rich. He spent 20 years doing trades in Shem. He was an orphan. He was a grandfather, etc. Many, many situations. So you can pick up and choose. If you are a student, you can look, for example, at the Prophet ﷺ when he was with Jibreel. Jibreel teaching him Quran. If you are a teacher, you can look at the Prophet ﷺ when he was teaching the companions in Dar al-Arqam wa al-Arqam, for example. If you are a father, you can look at the Prophet ﷺ with his children as well. If you are a husband, you can look at how the Prophet ﷺ used to behave with his wives. So this is why we want actually to study the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because it has great benefits, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has a role of has went through a broad of situation that allows us to benefit from. The third one is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the greatest character of history, no doubt about this. Now there is a final point I want to mention, and it's very important. Following the Prophet ﷺ, it's an Islamic duty. قُلْ أَطِيعُ اللَّهِ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولِ فَإِنْ تَوَلَّوْا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْكَافِرِينَ. Obeying the Prophet ﷺ is a duty. You haven't got a choice. How can you follow the Prophet ﷺ if you don't know who is he? You need to know him. You need to know him first. And the more you love him, the more you follow him. So that's our another aim of doing this dash of seerah, is loving the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Increase the love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we can follow him. So when we hear قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, what do we say? سمعنا وأطعنا. We heard and we obeyed. We don't say, come on brother. We follow the Quran and Sunnah. No. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ألا أوتيتُ الكتاب وَمِثْلَهُ وَمَعَهُ. I have been given the book, the Quran, and the same as the Quran, which is the Sunnah. Okay? So, these are the reasons why we would like to, inshallah, go through the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam next Friday, inshallah. Talk about the Prophet as a child, and then we will talk about the birth of the Prophet first as a child, and then as a young man, till we reach the marriage of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله السميع العليم من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم شر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum. I hope everything is fine, inshallah. You're on the heights of Iman and health, and that you're taking profits from the days of Ramadan. Last time, we spoke about the first hijra in Islam, the hijra to Habasha, Abyssinia. And we stopped at when Ja'far ibn Abi Talib has met the king, and when he had to summarize Islam in such a very, very tough situation. He only had a very short time to explain about Islam, about why they came to this land. We left it here. I will just summarize quickly the end of this story, and then we move to the next session, inshallah. Basically, if we were to ask you to talk about Islam, what would you say? We can probably do a test. I don't know if you're happy to take 30 seconds to talk about Islam. But when I do it, you haven't got time. But if we do this experiment, if someone says, you tell me about Islam, what would you say? And I think we are in this situation in Europe. People living outside Islamic countries, many times it does happen to us. Yesterday, for example, the brothers organized this session for the non-Muslims to talk about Islam. What should we say? Ja'far ibn Abi Talib had a very, very structured speech. I will just do it quickly. First, he said, we were in Jahiliyyah, and this is what happened to us. We were very bad neighbors. We used to eat dead meat. We used to do this and this and this. We used to worship statues, etc. He actually starts by mentioning the bad sides of Jahiliyyah, the bad sides of Quraysh. And then he said, that's the first part. Second part, فَجَاءَنَا رَسُولٌ مِنَّا. And then a prophet came among us. We know his lineage, we know his manners, we know him very well. We know he's trustworthy. And he ordered us to do. So that's the first part, is showing the bad parts, the bad sides of Jahiliyyah, and then talking about the Prophet ﷺ, his ID. Who is the Prophet ﷺ? And then the third part is actually mentioning what did the Prophet ﷺ told him. Then he said, the Prophet ﷺ ordered us to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be very good to our neighbors, to be truthful, to do so, etc. All things that everybody would agree that they are good things. And then he mentioned why Amr ibn al-As and his friend came to follow them. He said, فَاعْتَدَى عَلَيْنَا قَوْمُنَا. And then our tribe were really harsh with us. They oppressed us, etc., etc., only because we followed the Prophet ﷺ, etc. When the king heard this, basically he said, I'm not going to let them take you back to Mecca, because he's a just king. And now we can see the Prophet ﷺ had reason to send them to this land. We can see it here, that this king didn't make a judgment only by listening to a Najash. He had to listen to both. He said, I can't take a decision. I need to listen. I have listened to you, but I need to listen to them as well to be able to make a fair judgment. And we can see how Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, in a very short time, he could actually convince the king. Najashi. And then Najashi told him, do you have something from this, from what has been revealed to your Prophet? He said, yes. By the way, Surah Maryam has been revealed just before they come to Abyssinia. So Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, again, he said, yes, let me tell you about the Quran. And what did he recite? Surah Maryam, because Najashi was Christian. Okay. Here as well, look at the intelligence of the companions. Look at the da'wah skills we can gain as well. If someone's talking to you, if you know his background, then you have to actually adapt your message to be able to convince him based on his background. This is how the companions of the Quran used to use these skills to convince people and to guide them to Islam. When Najashi listened to Surah Maryam, he starts crying. And you can see the impact, again, the impact of the Quran on non-Muslims. You can ask the same question, how the Quran is impacting us in the days of Ramadan. That's what I wanted to say about the first Hijrah. And now, I would like to talk about the second Hijrah. During the oppression and the hardship in Mecca, the companions start organizing the Hijrah to Medina. The only people left in Mecca were the Prophet ﷺ and his family, and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Abu Bakr Siddiq, and his family. Okay? Quraysh understood that if the Prophet ﷺ traveled to Medina, it would have been a problem for them. It would mean that strong nation will start to build up in Medina. So they understood they should not let the Prophet ﷺ travel to Medina. They should avoid this hijra to happen. So they had this meeting in Dar al-Nadwa. Dar al-Nadwa is where they actually had their meetings, where they take their decisions. Okay, so you have Abu Jahl, Abu Sufyan, Umayyah ibn Khalaf, all gathered. They have to find a solution to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They have to do something to stop him from spreading the message of Islam. So basically they had three ideas. The first one, they said, we're going to kick him out. We're going to drive him out of Quraysh. Then Abu Jahl said, well, hold on a minute, we should not do this. Because if we let Muhammad free, he can go to other tribes and he can get them and gather them against us. We should not do this. We should be careful. Then another person said, oh, there is another idea. We can just chain him, put him in chains, block him from moving. Abu Jahl said, we can't do this. He still had his family in mind. Abu Banu Hashim, Asidi, they can just free him again. And then Abu Jahl stands and said, I have an idea for you. We're going to kill him. How? It's easy to say, but difficult to do. He said, all the tribes get the strongest man with a very, very long sword. And all come together and stand at the door of the Prophet ﷺ. So when he's coming out of his door, they just kill him at once. Why? So when Banu Hashim wants to take their revenge, he would struggle to do so. Against whom would they go? Because all the tribes are involved. So Abu Jahl had this idea to have all the tribes involved in this. And this is how he ensures his safety and safety of all the tribes. Okay? So that's the plan. Get different people from different tribes and let them go to the door of the Prophet ﷺ, wait until he's coming out, kill him all together. What's happened? Jibreel alayhi salam came to the Prophet ﷺ. Okay. Yeah, Muhammad. Quraysh wants to kill you. You have to leave now. and it was the morning, the Prophet was intended to leave during the night or later. But when Jibreel told him, they're going to kill you, you have to do something now. The Prophet understood that he needs to leave now. Okay? So that's the plan. So the Prophet went to Abu Bakr, to see Abu Bakr, in midday, and he put actually a veil around his face to hide it. Okay? Look at the Prophet how he takes the means. He put his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he do calculate every step. He doesn't say, well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will save me, I'm the last Prophet. That's fine. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do everything to save me. I am the messenger of Allah. And I say to Adam, I am the best of the mankind. No. This is not the teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is you put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you take all the means you can. If you're looking for a job, you do the best CV. And you prepare the best cover letter. And you prepare for the interview. You don't just, do everything, you rush everything and then you say, come on, it's on the hands of Allah. Yes, it is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the means? What is the teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? This is the teaching, this is the big lesson of Hijrah. Taking the means. Putting your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, tawakkal, wa lakin khud bil islam. Take the means. And put your trust in Allah. So, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to Abu Bakr and he said, Ya Abu Bakr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered me to do hijrah. Then Abu Bakr said, As-sahbatu ya Rasulullah, the friendship. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam answered, As-sahbatu ya Abu Bakr, yani, you're coming with me, inshaAllah. And Abu Bakr cried, the happiness. Although this trip is very dangerous, don't get me wrong. It's a dangerous trip. It's not very close. But Abu Bakr was very happy to be with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, regardless of dangers and hazards surrounding this trip. And Aisha radiallahu anha said, I've never seen Abu Bakr crying like he cries the days when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, you are doing hijrah. Look at the love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the love of Abu Bakr to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But before leaving, look at the Prophet ﷺ, look at the manners, look at the trustworthiness of the Prophet ﷺ. He has some belongings from Quraysh. Now they are trying to kill him. He can say, well, they are trying to kill me. I don't care about their belongings. No! The Prophet ﷺ told, Ya Ali, I still have some belongings from them, belonging to them. You need to give them back. To everybody. The Prophet can just throw them and say, okay, I don't care. They want to kill me. No. Yes, they're trying to kill me. But لكن يا رسول الله لكن الأمين the trustworthy. Look at the teaching of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Look how he deals with his enemies. They are trying to kill him. Yes. He tried to ensure that their belongings will go back to them. Look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then, he gets Ali to sleep in his bed. Why? By doing this, he can actually delay Quraysh. So he gets Ali to sleep in his bed. He told him, Ya Ali, you sleep in my bed, okay? And you stay there. So when they look inside, they can see someone laying down. And they can say, okay, the Prophet is still inside. Nothing to worry about. And they can just stay outside and waiting until the Prophet can gain some time and can go further. The Prophet he was trying to go out. What did he realize? He realized that these people that Abu Jahl gets to kill him are already there. sooner than was planned. So the Prophet ﷺ took a bit of dust in his hand and he recited, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ سُدًّا وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ سُدًّا فَأَغْشَيْنَاهُمْ فَهُمْ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ. And he threw the dust, so the dust fall into their heads and they fall asleep. And the Prophet ﷺ left. Just, you know, next to them, it was just, you know, they were in front of him, but they could not see him. Because why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving him glory because of the sacrifices he's done. He took all the means, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would give him glory because he took all the means. Then he went to Abu Bakr's house, and then they left, not from the front door, from the back of the house, again, taking the means. That's the lesson of today. Take all your means you can. Put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Take the means. He left from the back door of Abu Bakr's house. Then, Medina is on the north of Mecca. We have brothers here from Saudi, they know the geography. Medina is around 300, 500 kilometers?
Less. 70. From where?
From Mecca. The distance between Mecca and Medina.
400
kilometers. Medina is on the north. Quraysh is expecting the Prophet to go in the direction of the north. And what the Prophet will do? He will go in the direction of the south, in the mountain of Thawr. Mountain of Thawr, where there is the cave of Thawr, you know, the cave of Hijra. There's Ghar Hira, Ghar Thawr is the Ghar of the Hijra. 9 minutes. Okay? So the Prophet went at the opposite direction, opposite at their expectation. By the way, the Prophet, you know the age of the Prophet when he done Hijra? Who knows? You can guess.
It was around 40 years.
40 is the revelation. Those 40 was the revelation. Hijra is how many years after the revelation?
10 years.
No, more. 10 years in Medina. And how many years did the Prophet spend in Mecca? 13. So how old was he? 53. Prophet was 53 years. And Abu Bakr, 51. Okay? Allah could make everything easy for the Prophet, but there is a message here. A message of sacrifice. A message of doing the best you can for the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do your best, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you. But do your best at your level, at your capacity, at your capability. Do we really do our best today? That's the question. Maybe not. The mountain of Thawr is very, very difficult. It takes 2.5 hours to climb it. If you go to Saudi, you can visit the mountain of Thawr. So the Prophet ﷺ was 53 years old. Abu Bakr 51 years old. They had to climb a very, very difficult mountain. During this time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed some verses from Surah Al-Qasas. You know Surah Al-Qasas is talking about the story of Musa alayhi salam. Because Musa, same situation, they were trying to kill him. And then someone came to him and said, you have to go out because they're trying to kill him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is revealing these verses to recomforts the Prophet ﷺ, to give him some support. Because he needs it in these difficult situations. And then there is this verse, إِنَّ الَّذِي فَرَضَ عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ نَرَادُكَ إِلَى مَعَادٍ. Prophet ﷺ, don't worry, he will send you back to Mecca. You will go back to Mecca later, inshallah. So the Prophet ﷺ had went through a lot of struggle for us to be part of this ummah, for us to be explaining Islam wasn't easy. The companions of the Prophet had to do sacrifices and a lot of efforts. Later they asked Ali about these nights that he spent sleeping on the Prophet's bed. You can imagine the situation, he's 20 years old. And you know there's 10 or more guys outside with swords. And you know that if you go out, you can be hit. It's not an easy situation. You know? And they asked Ali, how did you spend these nights? He said, this is the quietest night I've slept during my whole life. The night I slept on the bed of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to this mountain of Toaufiq Abu Bakr. Till the top. They didn't stop at the middle. They had to go to the top. And then they found this cave. Obviously they need food because they stayed there for 3 days. Who is going to get the food there? Do you know? The daughter of Abu Bakr. Asma into Abu Bakr. Again, look at the role of woman in the society, in Islamic society. Woman never has never been excluded from the seerah. If you read the seerah, that's one of the messages you get, that woman was involved in all the stages of the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now why did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam get Asma to take food to them? Why? Anybody knows? Why would the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam get a woman to go 5 miles direction of the south of Mecca, climb this mountain, very difficult mountain, you need 2 hours to climb it up. Why? Because she was pregnant. Who would think that a pregnant woman would go to meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and bring food to him in this very difficult mountain? And she was, by the way, 7 months. Pregnant with 7 months. SubhanAllah. Again, look at the woman of the period of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A message for our sisters as well. That's a model for our sisters. And then Abu Jahl, obviously, when they knew about Ali staying there, they knew that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has left. Automatically they went to see Abu Bakr's house and they found Asma there. So Abu Jahl was telling him, where is your father? Can you imagine Abu Jahl and Asma, she can be shaky, she can say, oh, he went there. So, no, she had a lot of garbage. She said, Adam, don't say. She was really courageous and you know, a lot of courage. And obviously Abu Jahl hit her. On the face. And you look at the messages we get from this is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam again is taking the means and planning everything from A to Z. Okay. And we can get some points showing the planning of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. First one, he gets Ali to sleep in his bed. That's the first thing. Second, the Prophet went to see Abu Bakr at midday, because no one would expect him to go at this particular time. Number three, the Prophet was hiding his face when he went out, not to be known by the others. It was very, very discreet. Number four, the Prophet leaving Abu Bakr's house from the back, not from the front. Okay, a lot of planning and thinking. Although he knows, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him glory. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gets Asma to take the food. Because no one would think that a pregnant woman would take this difficult journey. I'm about to finish my speech about Hijrah. Lot of learnings. And the takeaway message is, put your trust in Allah, but take all the means you can. JazakumAllah khair. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله. ونعوذ بالله السميع العليم من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم. First 10 days of Ramadan are gone. The third of Ramadan is already gone. Who has been saved from the hellfire? Who has been accepted? Allah knows. We hope, inshallah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive our sins. That we have been saved from the hellfire. We still have another 20 days to go. I've noticed that the mosques starts getting empty. Subhanallah, only 10 days. So, brothers and sisters, keep doing your efforts. There is another 20 days to go. It's not finished yet. Do your best. Do your best, and may Allah accept from us. Today's talk is about Ghazwat Badr. The Battle of Badr. This is a great event in the seerah. Great moment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called the day of this battle Yawm al-Furqan. The split. Split between two periods, before and after. Because from this day of glory, Islam starts spreading and Muslims starts getting strong. And you can imagine that if Muslims would have lost this battle, then Islam would disappear. That was a key moment in the da'wah of the Prophet ﷺ, this battle. Let's go through this the moment of the Battle of Badr and try to get some learnings from this. By the way, this battle has a characteristic. This is the only battle where the angels were fighting with Muslims. It did not happen before, and it did not happen afterwards. It was particularly just on this particular battle of Badr that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent 1,000 angels with Jibreel alayhi salam to fight next to the companions. So this is one of the characteristics of this battle. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, along with this, had many preparations for the companions. One of the companions said, I was falling asleep. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told me to pay attention and to ensure security, etc. But I was falling asleep because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted them to have rest. إِذْ يُغَشِّيكُمُ النُّعَاسَ أَمَنَةً مِنْهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted them to have rest. And then the rain. Slight rain. So, as we move through the different stations of this battle, we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had a divine preparation for Muslims to win this battle. What's the reasons? Basically, when Muslims left Mecca to go to Hijra, Quraysh took everything they had. Money, houses, everything, camels. So they actually went out from Mecca without anything. They took their money. And what they've done with it, they spread it to all the families of Quraysh. They have shared the money that they took from the believers when they were trying to leave Mecca and to join Medina, to do their hijrah. So when the Prophet ﷺ heard about this convoy, this caravan coming from Sham, it was full of merchants, the Prophet ﷺ wants to get the money back. It's their money. The Prophet ﷺ went out from Medina with 313 companions to get their money back. So Quraysh, and this caravan was led by Abu Sufyan. They heard about it. So he led Mecca to know about this. By the way, Badr is 100 kilometers and 150 kilometers from Medina. The funny thing is, three people were sharing the same camel. Three on each camel. Permutation, commuting. So everybody will have to walk how many kilometers? If it's 150, more. You only take the camel for a third of distance because you have two other people. 100. You walk for 100 kilometers and you only take the camel for 50 kilometers. The Prophet ﷺ was, what's the age? He was 55 years old. Because Badr happened, by the way, in Ramadan. The battle of Badr was in Ramadan, 17th of Ramadan, the second year of Hijrah. So they were fasting. And it was the first year that the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prescribed fasting upon the believers. The first time, and there's a big test. The Prophet ﷺ was 55 years. And they were using the same camel, walking 100 kilometers. Have we ever done this distance? I did it. 100 kilometers. So the Prophet ﷺ was with Ali on the same camel. He was with Ali ibn Abi Talib and another companions. And Ali, out of kindness, out of respect to the Prophet ﷺ, he said, Ya Rasulullah, anta tarkab, wa nahnu namshi. You ride, and we walk. We don't want to let you struggle. You ride, and we walk. And the Prophet ﷺ answered, Wallahi ma antuma bi aqdar ala al-mashi minni, wa ma ana bi aqdar min al-thawab. It means, you're not stronger than me. I am 55 years. You're not stronger than me. I am stronger than you. Prophet ﷺ said this. Nowadays, you know, you can play football with people 20, 25 years, 30. 2 minutes, they are done. They can't trot in anymore. Because obviously, cigarettes, lack of activity. The Prophet ﷺ, 100 kilometers walking. And he was 55 years old. Very strong. So he said, you're not stronger than me, to Ali and the other companions. I am strong as well. And I am as well very keen on the ajr. This is the Prophet ﷺ saying so. I am very keen as well to get the reward. Although I am the Prophet ﷺ, the messenger of Allah, to whom Allah has forgiven all the sins, yet I am keen to get the ajr. Now we are in Ramadan. Everything has been done for us to worship and to get the reward. What's happened? 10 days after the start of Ramadan, mosques start getting empty. Why? SubhanAllah, this is a golden opportunity to worship, to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet ﷺ is keen to gain reward, and we aren't. How come? We should do our best. Because we need ajr more than the Prophet ﷺ, much more. We have sins, a lot of sins. So, what's the situation in Mecca? In Mecca, the auntie of the Prophet ﷺ made a dream, ru'ya. She saw a man standing on a mountain and saying, Ya Ahl Ghadr, Ya Ahl Ghadr, Masra'ukum ba'da thalathati ayyam. Oh, traitors, you're dead after 3 days. So she said, her brother, Al-Abbas, the uncle of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, she told him, I saw this. He told her, don't tell anybody. We don't want them to know this, because obviously they are from the same family of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They don't want to tell this. However, Abbas told someone, he told him, okay, I'm going to tell you something. Do not tell anybody. Keep it for yourself. He told him, Atika, Abbas of Rasulullah, Atika saw this and this and this. Oh, really? Same person who went and tell others. By the night, Mecca knew about his dream. This is when you tell someone secrets. And this person, mashallah, is not... not very trustworthy. Your secrets, everybody knows about it already in a couple of hours. So this is what happened. They knew about it. So Abu Jahl told Abbas, he told him, he was taking a mick of him. He told him, well, we knew about man pretending the prophecy. Now is it the case with woman as well? So he was taking a mick. We knew that from Banu Abi Abdul Muttalib that there is the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam pretending prophecy. Now it's his auntie as well. He told him, wallahi, if nothing happened in 3 days, we're going to stick a paper on Kaaba and we're going to say that Banu Abdul Muttalib are the liest people of Arab. Akdabul Arab. If nothing happened after three days, well, Abu Jahl died before that. So many things happened. And her ru'ya came true. So the kuffar starts preparing for the battle. They decided to go into battle against the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. There were thousands. Two of them did not go. Umayyah ibn Khalaf, you know Umayyah ibn Khalaf? You know him? He's one of the heads of Quraysh, very wealthy. But Umayyah ibn Khalaf and Abu Lahab. Abu Lahab, he died later, very bad ending. And Umayyah ibn Khalaf was insulting a companion. And the companion told him, you insult me? The Prophet ﷺ told us that she will die. He said, oh, did he say it so? Did he say where I'm going to die? Is it in Mecca or outside Mecca? He trusts the Prophet ﷺ. When he knew that it was the Prophet ﷺ who said this, then he's going to believe it. I mean, if you believe the Prophet ﷺ, why don't you follow him? That's stubbornness. Inad. To be stubborn. And stubbornness was a reason for many people from Quraysh to fall into the hellfire, wal'iyadu billah. La'inat. Like someone, brothers, go to pray. I know, brother, I know I have to pray, but give me some time, I need to reflect, I have to think about it. Sister, dress modestly, wear your hijab. I know I have to, but I'm too young, I'm just 20, I still have time. Come on, I will do hajj when I'm 60, and then inshallah I will wear my hijab. Stubbornness, inad. You know the truth? You don't want to follow it. That's Umayyah ibn Khalaf. He knew that the Prophet is saying the truth. For him to follow, no, that's another story. Inad. To be stubborn. Don't be like this. So, Abu Sufyan managed to save the caravan. You would think there is no point to win the war because they saved their money. Abu Jahl said, no, we have a proudness. We need to go there, kill them, and stay for 3 days, eating food and to show the Arabs that we are strong. So they decided to go for the battle. But they had an issue. They had an issue. Quraysh had a problem with a tribe called Kinana. So they were afraid that if they leave Quraysh, Kinana would attack them. And something funny happened here. Shaitan took a took the image of one of the noble persons, one the noble people of Kinana, Suraq ibn Malik. وَإِذْ سَيِّنَا لَكُمْ الشَّيْطَانُ أَعْمَالُكُمْ قَالَ لَا غَلِبَ لَكُمْ إِلَى آخَرَ سَلْ آيَا بِصَرْتِهُ. So, Shaitan took the personality of Suraq ibn Malik and he saw them, he said, don't worry, I am ensuring your safety. I am from Kinana. I am a high senior guy from Kinana. I ensure you that nothing will happen to you. But obviously, when Shaitan, when Iblis saw the angels and Jibreel helping the Muslims, نَكَسَ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ وَقَالَ إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ in Surah Al-Anfal. Then, obviously, he left them. He said, I'm not going to stay with you anymore. And obviously, this is how Shaitan does with us. It's the same strategy. From 1430 years ago, in the Battle of Badr, how he did with the Kuffar Quraysh, he's doing exactly the same with us. Just go ahead. Don't be afraid. Do it. Oh, I'm thinking taking a mortgage. Don't. Just do it. Get the flat. That's fine. Go ahead. Don't worry. But in Yawm al-Qiyam, oh, didn't tell you anything. So the Prophet ﷺ, in this situation, they knew that they're going to war. He was asking for advice. Ya ayyuha al-nas, ashiru alayhi. Give me your advice. So look at the Prophet ﷺ. He's not, oh, I am the leader, I do my way. The Prophet ﷺ is the messenger, the best man of the mankind, yet he's asking for advice. Look at the modesty of the Prophet ﷺ. Be modest. So Abu Bakr said had a great speech. Umar as well. And Miqdad said, Ya Rasulullah, we're not going to say like Bani Israel, who said to Musa, go with your God and fight. We stay here. No, we say the opposite. Go with your God and fight, and we come with you. We are with you. And the companion said, Ali, if we would have given Jabal Uhud of gold just to say this, because the Prophet ﷺ was very happy to hear this word. But he was continuing to say, Ya ayyuha al-nas, ashiru alayhi. So, if you look at the names Abu Bakr, Umar and Al-Miqdad, they are all from Mecca, Muhajirin. The Prophet ﷺ wants to hear from Ansar, people of Medina. And then Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, the leader of Medina, he stands and he had this speech that I will read upon you, and please reflect. He said, O Messenger of Allah, we have believed in you, and we believe that you are saying the truth. We give you, based on that, our covenant to listen to and obey you. By Allah, the one who sent you with the truth, if you were to enter the sea, we would rush into it with you, and that not one of us would stay behind. And later he said, may Allah show you in our actions what will satisfy your eyes. We should say the same and do this dua. May Allah show you, Ya Rasulullah, in our actions, especially during this month of Ramadan, what will satisfy your eyes, inshallah, عند الحوض. Now, we 2 minutes, subhanAllah. Lots to say in a very, very short time. Strategy. The Prophet ﷺ told them, there is different wells in Badr. We stay behind. One of the companions, not very known, Al-Habbab ibn al-Mundir, look at the positiveness of the Prophet, of the companions. He said, Ya Rasulullah, is it revelation? Is it an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do so? Or is it war and its tactics? He said, Rasulullah said, yes, it is the war and its strategy. We need to use our minds. So Al-Habbab ibn al-Mundir said, then Ya Rasulullah, we shouldn't do this. This is an advice from an expert. Again, when you do your projects at work or at community work, take advice from experts. You cannot be expert in everything. Look at the Prophet ﷺ. So Habbab bin Mudr told him, Ya Rasulullah, we destroy all the wells, we leave only one. And we let it behind us, so we can feed, and they can't. So we can take energy, and they can't. And Rasulullah ﷺ approved it. He said, yes, that's good advice. Something for us to learn. Ideas. If you have good ideas, make your brothers and sisters benefit from them. In the mosques, local community, be a positive citizen. Be someone that your community benefits from. Don't be someone useless. One thing I want to highlight, and I will finish with it. When the battle starts, Abu Ubaid ibn al-Harith was fighting against Al-Walid ibn Utbah, and he was dying. He was dying in the battle. And they took him to the Prophet ﷺ, and he put his face on the Prophet ﷺ thigh. He was bleeding, actually his legs was you know, about to be annihilated. And he was pleading. Can you imagine the situation? And he said, Ya Rasulullah, Aradin anni Ya Rasulullah. Someone who is dying, he's turning his face to the Prophet. Ya Rasulullah, are you satisfied upon me? Do we care about the fact that the Prophet is satisfied upon us? Or we just live our life like this? And I want to add on this, puts the satisfaction of the Prophet ﷺ as a target for all your deeds. Whatever you do, make the satisfaction of the Prophet ﷺ a target. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم استغفر الله.
لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا. Brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم. Today is nearly the 17th of Ramadan, and you remember our first dars, we were talking about the preparation and how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the days of Ramadan. And we've said that Ramadan will go very fast, and you can see it by your eyes now. It's the 17th day. We can't realize how quickly these days pass by. So inshallah, may Allah make us among the believers who will be saved from the hellfire during this month, inshallah. I ask Allah that all of the brothers and sisters will be forgiven during this month of Ramadan, inshallah. Now, this is the last session of Seerah. Unfortunately, we did not have enough time to go deeply in each event, in each situations of the seerah. However, I think from the very little we covered, there is lessons that we can take. There is things that we can implement. And I would like to summarize in a couple of points, maybe some ideas to try to implement in our daily lives, inshallah, that I've taken from the lessons of seerah we've seen so far. The first one, the mercy. Subhanallah, we've seen a lot of division now among Muslims. There is a lot of division. Muslims are weak, mainly because there is a lot of division between them. That's something we have to sort out. Before looking at others, we have problems to sort out between each other. Muslims are fighting against each other. There's a lot of division. هذا on this madhab, the other on this madhab, the other on this other ta'ifa. It is like, you know, we are very harsh towards our brothers. And look at the mercy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I would like to mention the story of Hudaybiyah. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was going to do Umrah that he dreamt about, on his way to Mecca, Khalid ibn al-Walid was trying to catch them, to fight against them. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he wanted peace. He did not want to fight with Khalid ibn al-Walid. So he took another path. And when they were traveling, they took a very difficult path. When they were traveling, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw a female dog giving birth. A female dog giving birth. So what did Prophet Hassan say? He told the companions to change the path. Not to disturb this female dog, because she was giving birth. Now look at the mercy of the Prophet on animals. On animals. And the Prophet had mercy even upon non-Muslims. Look at the mercy of the Prophet. If we really love him, we should follow him. Do we have mercy upon each other? Do we have mercy upon our brothers, our parents, our wives, our husbands, our colleagues? So that's the first point. Have mercy upon the others. The second point, if when you see the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the things that is highlighted so easily is the tests and the hardships. Ibtilaat. When I say ibtilaat, ibtilaat of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When he was a kid, he lost his father, his mother, then his grandfather, then his uncle, then later his wife Khadija, then all his kids. Can you imagine this? If someone had this now, he would be very violent. He would be psychiatric, you know, he would have lots of psychiatric problems. Because he would say, I had a lot of issues when I was a kid. Yet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was just giving kindness. With all the tests he had, he's giving kindness, mercy. Imagine the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was a boy called Umayr. He was playing with a little bird. So every time the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to tell him, Ya Umayr, kayfa halu an-nughayr? He gave a name to this bird. Ya Umayr, kayfa an-nughayr? Etc. And one day, this little boy was sad. So the Prophet asked him, Ya Umayr, kayfa an-nughayr? Qala abat an-nughayr ya Rasulullah. An-nughayr, the little bird died, ya Rasulullah. So the Prophet had to stay for 1 hour just to distract him for a bird who died. Subhanallah. Tests didn't make him to be harsh. The test and the hardship he went through made him very kind. And this is a lesson for us. When you go through different tests and hardship, they have to make you stronger. You have to withdraw conclusions from the tests. It may be divine preparation for you. And maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is preparing for you something with the higher importance. Like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, during his life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was preparing for a risalah, for the message. وَأَشَدُّ النَّاسِ ابْتِلَاءً الْأَنْبِيَاءِ يُبْتَلَى الْمَرْءُ عَلَى قَدْرِ إِيمَانِهِ. The test is a function of your faith, of your iman. The other point is to stay focused. Stay focused. What was the main message of the Prophet ﷺ? What was the main objective of the risalah of the Prophet ﷺ? Is to transmit the message of La ilaha illallah. And you can see in the year 6 of Hijrah, the Prophet ﷺ was strong and Quraysh was very weak. The Muslims were fine in Medina. They were worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in quietness, no problem, etc. They could say, well, that's fine, we can just stop here. We are fine. We're praying, we're fasting, Muslims are okay, we have a strong Muslim Ummah in Medina, we can just stop. No. The Prophet ﷺ stayed focused. My aim is not this. My aim is خَلُّوا بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ النَّاسِ. Don't intervene between me and other tribes. My mission is to transmit the values and the principles of Islam. And question that is open for us, what's our main objective? What's the purpose of our lives? Sometimes we have studies, work, sometimes problems, family problems, etc. We get distracted. We have to stay focused. What's my main objective? That's the third point. The other point is taking the means plus tawakkul. You remember it. This is one of the conclusions we've withdrawn from Ghazwat Badr. Okay? Take the means. Prophet ﷺ was doing everything in his possible in his level. He gets Ali to sleep in his bed. He gets Asma to bring the food because she was pregnant. He was preparing everything. And this doesn't go against tawakkul. They go next to each other. It is part of good tawakkul to take the means. You cannot say I'm doing tawakkul and I'm sleeping. I'm not acting. I'm not brothers who are now looking for a job. You cannot say I'm doing tawakkul and your CV is bad. You have to do everything you can. You have a good degree. You get the skills that you need for this job, etc. Do whatever you can at your level. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you. That's one of the messages. Because we have a lot of laziness now in our Islamic culture, unfortunately. And subhanAllah, Islam is against laziness. The Prophet ﷺ used to seek refuge from laziness. You know, dua, Allahumma inna na'udu bika min al-kasal. Every morning and evening, we do dua, we seek refuge from laziness. Who are the most lazy people? Unfortunately, subhanAllah, Muslims in the Islamic countries. We haven't got any value for time. I mean, I can talk about my home country. If you, for example, for civil certificates, etc., you can wait for a week. That's a 5-minute job. You can wait for a week. Why? Because people are lazy. They don't care. They lost the value of time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by time. Wal asr. Everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used to swear with, it's something great. Al asr, wal duha, inna salata kanat al mu'minin kitaban manquta. We find time everywhere. Pray. Siyam is a month. Hajj, particular days. Ayyam al bayt, particular days. The time is very present in our Islamic practice. We shouldn't be the ones who give very little importance to time. The other point is be positive. Be an active member of your community, of your society. Look at Habab, Sayyidina Habab radiallahu anhu, in Ghazwat Badr. The Prophet ﷺ told him, we're going to go back up behind the wells. He said, Ya Rasulullah, is this a revelation? So I accept it. So look at adab. Look at the manners with the Prophet ﷺ. He first asked him, Ya Rasulullah, is this a revelation? If it's a revelation, سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا, we follow. If not, then I am an expert in this field. I can suggest ideas. I can suggest new things. And that's what he done. Ya Rasulullah, we destroy all the wells. We let one well and we use it. And we let the well behind us. So we use the well, we drink, we take energy, and they don't. And the Rasulullah, yes, approved. We should be like these companions. Companions used to take initiative. They weren't people just sitting very poor. That's the wrong stereotypes people have upon companions. The companions were very active. They used to be intelligent people. They used to be present in commerce. They used to learn the Quran. They used to do many things. They had such a lot of barakah in their time. So that's a couple of points I want to remind myself and yourself, inshallah, from the seerah, and inshallah, may Allah give us the opportunity to implement them in our life. Now the question is, how can't we not love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after this? We can only love him. How can you not love him? And that's my second thing I would like to talk about is the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How do we understand this love? Because we نَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَى اللَّهِ بِحُبِّ رَسُولِهِ. It's actually worship, loving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of the fruits of the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is following him. Tibah. If you truly love him, you have to follow him. You cannot say, oh, I love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I love him. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this is not true love. If you love someone, you can see it with a man and his wife, for example. If a man loves his wife, he's gonna, she tells him, I would like this, whatever, this dress or this bag, he will buy it for her. that's a small example, but when you love, you do whatever. It's in your means to satisfy the loved, the beloved person. And the love of the Prophet ﷺ is translated by following. He done a lot for us, a lot of sacrifices, Rasulullah ﷺ and the companions, for us to be Muslims, for Islam to come to us easily, and we are born Muslims. So the true lover of the Prophet ﷺ gives glory to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ with his time, with his money, with everything he has. So inshallah, when you meet him in al-Hawt, you know al-Hawt? The lake. In the judgment day, the Prophet ﷺ will have a lake. You know, in this heat. And it will be a long time, we'll have to wait for a long time. Thousands and thousands of years, just waiting for the judgment day to start. We're just waiting for Ardh Mahshar. Imagine, people just waiting. And people in their sweat. So there is people in which the sweat, you know, the sweat is actually water. Till the knees, or till the neck, or people actually drowning in their sweats. Because of the heat. Walakin, there is people who will be on the shade of Allah's throne. Sab'atun, you know the seven categories, you know this hadith. Sab'atun yudallahum Allahu bidalli ashi yawm la dalla illa dalla. Among them, a young man who has been raised into worship, etc. This is not the topic of today, but the Prophet ﷺ will have a lake. And he will give us, inshallah, to drink from this water, from this lake. How will he recognize us? Do you know how? How will the Prophet ﷺ? Yes, from the wudu. Believers will have their hands, their feet white. You know, like the horses, you know, the horse, like all the color is brown and the legs are white. The wudu parts will be white. This is how the Prophet will recognize us. Unfortunately, there will be people who will come to the Prophet looking to drink from this water. You won't get thirsty after drinking from this water. But the angels will take him. So the Prophet said, Innahu min ummati, he's from my ummah. Why are you taking him away? They will say, Innaka la tadri ma daf'a min ba'dik. You don't know what he has been doing after you. Because we came after the Prophet, right? The angels will tell him, you don't know what he has been doing after you. And the Prophet will tell them, Bu'dan bu'dan, take him away. Take him, I don't need him. So, we can see the importance of following the Prophet. No one wants to be in this situation. You're very happy. That's the first meeting we have with the Prophet. We haven't met him yet. That's the first meeting, and he tells you, go away. That's serious. Imagine your first meeting, you're happy. Ah, subhanAllah, meet the Prophet. You're taken away. Go away. Why? Because we've been doing things that he didn't order us to do. Now there is a lot of people who said, well, we don't need sunnah, everything is in the Quran. Hold on a minute. How can you understand the Quran without sunnah? A sunnah? It's explaining the Quran. And the Prophet said, تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ شَيْئَيْنِ لَمْ تَضِلُّوا بَعْدَهُمَا كِتَابُ اللَّهِ وَسُنَّتِي. I left between you two things. If you follow them, you won't be misguided ever. كتاب الله القرآن وسنتي and my sunnah. And Ibn al-Qayyim said, القرآن مع السنة في ثلاثة وجوه. The Quran and sunnah are actually the relationship between them. We can point them in three points. The first one is where sunnah, when we say sunnah, is the deeds of the Prophet ﷺ, is what he said and what he approved. Sunnah qawliya is what he said, sunnah fi'liya what he did, and sunnah taqririya is what the companions has said and the Prophet ﷺ, he approved it. This is what we call sunnah. So the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ can be exactly like the Qur'an, matching with the Qur'an. That's the first case. The second case is when the sunnah clarify what is in the Qur'an. Who can give me an example? Salat. Inna salata kanat ala al-mu'minina kitaban mawquta. This is a verse. How you pray? How do you pray? How do we pray? Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli. Pray as you've seen me praying. So the sunnah is showing us how to pray. Another example is hajj. Khudu manasikakum anni. Take your hajj practice upon me, follow me. And Allah is just telling us in the Quran to do hajj. He didn't tell us how to physically do it. So it is very important. And the other case is when the sunnah comes with tahrim or tahleel by itself. Okay? When the sunnah comes with the new rulings that were not in the Quran. So we have these three cases. The sunnah and the Quran are same level. We should not say Quran, then sunnah. Same level. وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا. سبحان الله. ابن القيم said, ولا يكون الرجل من أتباع النبي حقا حتى يدعو إلى ما دعا إليه رسول الله. You're not truly a true follower of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم until you transmit, until you call. يعني تدعو إلى ما دعا إليه الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. You kind of do da'wah of the same things that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was calling upon. So we said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was calling upon mercy, was calling upon tawheed, was calling upon truthfulness. All these values, we are the ambassadors of these values. In the university, in work, in my family, everybody will have to be the ambassador of the Prophet's manners in his circle. Be this person. Whatever you know about the Prophet ﷺ, try to implement. Transmit upon me even a verse. This is a hadith sahih. Prophet has been calling us to transmit and forward the knowledge. So if you have your family, your kids, your wife, have like, you know, sessions with them. Or even your friends, have like sessions where you sit and you discuss about religion and try to benefit others from what you know. Don't be shy. Don't be shy. People, sometimes they are very shy to talk about religion. Say, well, it's okay. They, you know, people knows what they are doing. I'm not going to tell them. You know, don't be shy. SubhanAllah. There's people talking about, you know, stupid subjects. And you know, and they don't care. And we have the truth. We have the treasures. Yet we are shy to share them. We shouldn't have any problem sharing the knowledge, sharing the values of the Prophet ﷺ. Why? Because we are proud. We are proud of our religion. We are proud of our identity. And there is nothing to hide. SubhanAllah, let me remind you, the first pillar of Islam is Shahada. First pillar is Shahada. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. You attest that the Prophet ﷺ is the messenger. We can talk forever about Shahada. But the meaning of Shahada is that, you know, you accept that the Prophet ﷺ is a messenger of Allah. And this obviously implies that you have to follow him. Some of the scholars said this very good meaning. He said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. This is the first part, then, any who to worship. Have to worship only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How do you worship him? By following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the second half. Okay? You can only worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in lawful manner. You cannot just worship without referring to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You can say, no, I actually want to fast like this, or I want to pray like this. No. All the worships are not accepted until you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has worshipped. This is fundamental. Al-asl fi ibadati tahrim. We don't go on this. So, if you love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how is your relationship with your parents? How is your relationship with your wife? Do you implement? Do you follow sunnah with your wife? How is your relationship with your kids? How is your relationship with your colleagues at work? How is your relationship with your family members, with your friends? How is your worship? How is our worship? كيف نعبد الله؟ كيف أحوالنا مع القرآن؟ And when you say following the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, is in all these bullet points. It's not one particular science. Is this whole thing. But obviously we have an issue. We have an issue. We are different from the companions. Why? A companion called Jundab radiallahu anhu said in hadith, I mean, the meaning of this hadith, that we came to the Prophet ﷺ and we learned Iman first. Then we learned Quran. Iman here, بمعنى التسليم, the acceptance. Iman, آمنت بشيء, يعني تقبلته هو, يعني تسلمته. I, Iman, in the meaning of acceptance of the revelation. He said, we learned Iman first. Then we learned Quran. This is fundamental. And all the generation after the companions is different from this. This is why the companions have such a high status in Islam. Why? Because we learned Quran and then we learned Iman. Now you may say, why, what's the difference? Well, the difference is the companions, they had a very strong Iman. When they used to listen to the Quran, to the verses of the Quran, to the rulings of the Quran, they didn't have any problem to say, we obey. For us, we have lots of issues. With some verse, we say, how can we do this? How can we accept this? It's a bit tricky. We have this issue. Why? Because we learned the Quran. And when we were learning the Quran first, there is many things that we didn't understand. This is the fundamental difference between us and the companions. We have, the Ummah has a lot of rejection from many of us. From many of us. There is people who don't pray. There is people who don't fast. There is people who eat riba. For everything, there is people who are actually rejecting at least one of the rulings of Islam. Now, they can't reject Quran. They cannot say Quran is mistaken or something like this. Because we know that Quran is the book that is... there is no other book in the earth that has been given the authenticity that the Quran has been given. Alhamdulillah, there is kids everywhere memorizing the Quran, memorizing every vowel of it. So there is no issue with the authenticity of the Quran. There is an issue with the meanings. And more, we have an issue with the Sunnah, because usually the Quran is more accepted. It is the Sunnah that people have a lot of rejection upon. I want you to link this. I want you to link the Seerah with this, because now that's the normal, the normal next step. When you know about the Prophet, the first step is to know about the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You cannot follow someone you don't know. You have to know him. When you know him, you love him. And when you love him, it's easier for you to follow him. Because this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us to do. Atiyya Allah wa Rasul. Say, obey Allah and his messenger. And the messenger. This is what we are asked to do. To follow. When we read seerah and when we love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then we are more inclined to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And subhanAllah, this, we can see this clearly. This idea of rejection, the idea of rejecting Sunnah, we can see it now. One of the shaykh said, a woman, she was actually making hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari. A woman said, the Prophet ﷺ said in this hadith narrated in Bukhari, تصدقنا تصدقنا فإني رأيتكنا أكثر أهل النار. The day of Eid, the Prophet ﷺ was asking women to give sadaqah because he saw them, the majority of Jahannam. So he told them, give sadaqah. Now one lady, she said, the Prophet ﷺ cannot do this. That's a day of Eid. It's a day of joy, day of happiness. He cannot tell them this. This hadith must be wrong. Hadith narrated in Bukhari. And subhanAllah, this is not how we judge if something is authentic or not. It's a knowledge. If someone, if I come to you and I tell you, well, you gotta, if you have pain, I tell you, well, take this medicine, it's good for you. So you're gonna tell me, come on, you wanna make me sick? You're not a doctor. Why are you telling me to do this? And in other fields, it's not allowed that someone gives his opinion if he doesn't know the insights of what he's talking about. But in religion, everybody gives fatwa, everybody knows everything, knows hadith, knows Quran, etc. We should refer to the people of knowledge. We should not discard the hadith because we don't like it or because we don't understand it. Imam al-Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi, you know the hadith of the fly. We all know this hadith. You know it? The Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said the meaning of it. If you find the fly on your on a deck and it falls in your cup, then what do? Dip it inside. Imam al-Nawawi said that hadith la yu'malu bi anything. Imam Nawawi said, this hadith, we don't use it. He didn't say it's not authentic. He said, this hadith is authentic. Sahih al-Sanad, his chain is authentic. However, we don't use it. Now, the attitude now is to say, this hadith, I don't understand it. It must be da'if. And subhanAllah, now, science has proven that the flies has two wings. One wing has the bacteria and the other fly, the other wings, and the other wing has the antidotes. You see, the benefit of preserving the hadith and preserving the sunnah. We may not have the understanding for it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may make people coming after us who will have better understanding. Okay? And by the way, ilm al-hadith is a very, very strong, field for those who are interested in Islamic studies. And the attitude now is to say, because they can, obviously no one can say the Prophet is lying. Hasha in there. He said, no, Prophet is saying truth. But the narrators, they are like us. They can make mistakes. Yes, they can make mistakes. But the question is, have they done mistake in this particular hadith or not? That's it. And this is what it's about in hadith. It's about chains of narration. Okay, I think I'm done. I would like to thank all of you. Jazakumullah khair. For the efforts in this holy month. May Allah accept from me, inshallah. May Allah give us, grant us ikhlas. Allah only accepts the deeds who are done truthfully for His sake. So we ask Allah to grant us ikhlas. We ask Allah to make us among the people who are accepted from this holy month. Allahumma la taj'al minna wa la fina shaqeen wa la fina. قولوا قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم استغفر الله جزاكم الله خيرا